I received a number of queries about my fish tank when I used it for an image processing video on my derekmolloy.ie website. When I said that I used a custom LED light setup, there were a good few people interested. So here I'm just releasing a short video on my personal YouTube channel that details how I built my setup. In total, my DIY LED setup cost about €100, which is about $130, which is fairly low cost for the light output that I'm achieving over the full fish tank. I achieved this by custom building the LED circuits and by some IKEA hacking. For this installation, I'm using 23mm star PCBs, each with 4 Cree XP-G R5s. I bought these from ledtech.de and they cost about €7.90 each. They're described on the website as having a lumen output of between 556 and 1952 lumen, depending on the current that you drive to them. To put these numbers in context, a 100 watt incandescent bulb, a standard bulb, outputs about 1160 lumen on the 220 volt supply in Ireland. The nice thing about LED lights for an application like this is that they have an efficiency of about 113 lumens per watt, whereas an incandescent bulb is about 11.6, so it's about 10 times more efficient. Not that you'd be lighting your fish tank with 100 watt bulbs anyway. So according to the specifications, these stars have a forward current of between 350 milliamps typical and 1.5 amps, with a forward voltage of between 14 volts and 15 volts. At the typical forward current of 350 milliamps, they run at 5 watts for the star, and the output is 556 lumen per star. I paired them with Cree XP 4-type optic 15 degree, they're plastic covers from the same company for about €2.50 each. So I'm paying approximately €10 for each of the 6 lights on the rail. That's not bad for the lighting output that I'm getting. On the surface of the 23mm stars are 4 XPG LEDs, and these are XPG WHT R5s. You can see from the data sheet here on the third line down that the R5s have a luminous flux of 139 lumen at 350 milliamps and 260 lumen at 700 milliamps. So you're trading off light output against current and therefore the power required to drive the LEDs. The higher the current, the hotter they'll run and the more important it is to dissipate the heat. I always try to drive LEDs at their typical settings as this helps with their lifespan and is usually where you get the highest light output per watt. For this type of application where the lights are going to be on for long periods, I think it's best to go for a power efficient setup. To keep costs down, I'm going to IKEA hack. You need to sink the heat from the LEDs, and one of the best materials for this is aluminium. You can buy custom aluminium extrusions that can be very expensive and often difficult to get delivered. I'm going to use IKEA curtain rail. It costs about €12 for a 1.4 meter length and is of a very high quality with a profile that really suits this application. IKEA also sell mounting brackets, which are very useful for my installation where the lights are suspended over the tank behind a marine ply wall that's coated with waterproof latex rubber. Here you can see the side profile of the extruded aluminium. I'm going to use it upside down compared to its intended use, as that is the flat part of the rail and it will allow me to attach the aluminium stars to it to get the maximum surface contact. So here are the steps that I took in building this lighting rail. First, work out the number of lights and the forward current and forward voltage values. I'm planning to use 6 of these stars on my rail, so I need a configuration and a power supply that allows me to drive them at 350 milliamps. LEDs are current driven, so with this LED, if I drive it with 350 milliamps forward current, it will drop approximately 14 volts or 14 volts forward voltage. So if I was to drive them at 350 milliamps in series, that's one after the other, 6 in a row, I would need a supply that delivers 350 milliamps with a voltage drop capability of 6 times 14 volts, which is 84 volts. That's quite high for a power supply. Since I can't find one of these easily, I'm going to look at splitting the current. So if I split them into pairs, so if I have 3 in 2 rows, I can drive 700 milliamps from the supply, which will split evenly into 2 rows equally at 350 milliamps, and then there will be a voltage drop across each side of 3 times 14 volts, which is 42 volts. Make sure that you have the same number of stars on each row, otherwise the light level will be uneven at best, and at worst you could damage the stars. So, I need a constant current power supply that will deliver 700 milliamps and can do this while dropping 42 volts. This voltage drop might be defined in terms of power output, where power, P, is equal to voltage times current. So P is in watts, so 42 volts times 0.7 amps. 700 milliamps is 0.7 of an amp. The supply has to be capable thereof delivering about 30 watts. So it just so happens that LED Tech have one that suited me. I've nothing to do with LED Tech, by the way. The LCP35700 is capable of delivering up to 33.6 watts at 700 milliamps. And that's more than sufficient for my needs. It can deliver voltage levels between 9 volts and 48 volts. So a voltage drop of 42 volts is within the tolerance too. It's also an IP67 power supply. So since it's going to be around water, that's a very good idea. IP67 allows immersion for up to 30 minutes, which should never, immersion in water for 30 minutes, which should never happen. In theory, this setup should give 6 times 556 lumen output, which is 3,336 lumen output at a cost of around 30 watts to the LEDs from the transformer. The transformer's 85% efficient, so that's a cost of about 39 watts from the socket, from the wall socket. In my case, I first soldered stranded cable to the stars. To do this, it is best if you use stranded cable that you freshly cut and then tin it by adding a small amount of solder to the wire. Then, holding the wire, touch the wire to the pad of the star with the soldering iron and let the solder flow. Whatever you do, don't connect the star to the aluminium rail first, as the rail will sink the heat from the solder iron and you won't get the pad to heat up enough to take the solder. Next, I then drilled tiny holes in the rail using a HSS bit for small screws to hold the stars in place. I drilled some larger holes so that I could route the wires to the back of the rail. Before I placed the stars with the screws, I used thermal heat compound between the back of the star and the rail, and then I screwed the stars to the rail. There are also glues, thermal glues available that would do this job instead of a screw, but they can be quite expensive. The lens is then popped onto the surface holes of the stars. I ran wires through the larger holes and into a small piece of perf board where I wired the LEDs together just like in my circuit diagram. Once that's done, test that it works before you go any further. I connected power and all was in order. The stars and the rail get a little bit warm, but it's nothing worth talking about. I then used a glue gun to hold the wires in place and to give the perf board some degree of waterproofness. In my case, the rail isn't visible from the front of the fish tank, so it didn't have to be very neat. I also used some glue from my glue gun around the LED lenses to hold them in place. Once this is done, I mounted the rail holders and the power supply to the back ply wall of my fish tank enclosure and placed the rail in the placed it over the water. In my case, the power wire runs to a special waterproof and moisture-proof connection box that's connected to my lighting ring, so the fish tank lights are on a switch in the room to the front of the tank. Automatically turning the lights on and off will be a nice automation project at some stage, perfect for an Arduino and a relay. And that's it. So the total cost of my system was about €60 for the LEDs, €20 for the power supply, and about €20 for the curtain rail and brackets. Excluding the small parts, that was exactly €100. And I've had it running for several months now, and it's working really great. I'm not sure if the fish noticed any difference, but the colour of the light and the tank in the room look great. I'm not claiming that this is the best way to build a DIY LED fish tank light, but hopefully it gives you some ideas on how to do it yourself.